So one of the challenges of this topic is it's so broad and it's meant to include so many different groups. So I pray that inshallah that I can do justice to this topic, because it's an important topic that we desperately need to address within our community. And so what I want to do is, sometimes we think we know this topic, we think we understand it's important, but we really don't have the emotional connection to this topic. And so I think it's really important for us to really think about our personal experiences with being marginalized, right? Because each and every one of us at some point in time has experienced some form of marginalization, feeling excluded, feeling left out, being pushed, not given a voice, right? As if to say that what we said or did not matter, that we didn't belong within the community or within our society. And so I'd like you to all think about one of those incidents. I know for me, alhamdulillah, I've had many incidents, and each incident is used to grow from. But one of the incidents that I think could have had a really negative impact for me was my experience in graduate school. I remember my advisors telling me that, you know, I shouldn't study Muslim youth. I shouldn't do research in this area because nobody cares. Nobody's going to be interested in that. I remember being given a hard time to go for Hajj when I was in school. And I remember telling my advisor, of all people, the person who's supposed to be my advocate, telling me that I would never be a good psychologist because of the fact that I hadn't lived the American life, whatever that means, right? As if there's only one American reality. And I remember in those moments feeling so dejected, feeling so confused, and feeling like I can't believe what I just heard. I can't believe what I experienced, right? So each one of you have had something similar at some point in your life. So I want you to kind of go back to that experience and think about it. Right? How do you remember the hurt? Do you remember the anger? The frustration?
So he said, be careful of your words.
Tap into that energy. And now I want to tell you and inform you, just like you experienced that hurt from outside, you are likely doing the same thing to your brothers and sisters in faith.
She travels back to her home to feed her children.
You may be doing this knowingly or unknowingly, but the same pain that you have felt, you have also incurred that hurt on other individuals, people who share the same faith.
Naturally, she would become upset.
In a study done by Muslim Arc, 2 out of 3 Muslims reported feeling discriminated by other Muslims. 2 out of 3. Of those who were studied, who are African American, 80% reported being discriminated against by fellow Muslims. You know, and some of it, we know, it's direct. You know, people calling our Muslim brothers and sisters abid or not considering them for marriage. You know, those are the direct ones we know about, right? But sometimes it's more indirect, right? Sometimes it's not validating black culture. Why is it biryani and ma'luba are fine meals to have at community events, but collard greens and bean pie everyone looks at? Right? How many people have been to a community where that's acceptable? And that's the norm. Right? Food is culture. How do we look at people and acknowledge issues like school-to-prison pipeline? Black Lives Matter. Why is that not an issue at the same level, degree, and interest as our enthusiasm is for Palestine or Syria? Is it not our issue? And so these are the things that we need to question ourselves. Are we not having programming in our messages on these topics? Why? These are the questions we need to ask ourselves. Similarly for females, 60% of women in that study reported being discriminated against by fellow Muslims, right? You know, it could be being made to feel that they don't belong in certain places, and I'm sure most women have felt the experience, ooh, I'm accidentally in the men's side. Oh, what are people going to say, right? That's happened. I used to go to a masjid for 15 years, never realized that there was a library in that masjid. And I'm not like once in a while going to the masjid type person. I would be going on a weekly basis, not knowing that there was a masjid, there was a library. Why? Because that library was in the men's section. How are women supposed to get educated if they don't even have access to that to the library? It's these spaces that we need to realize. It's how we organize our spaces, how we organize our time, our priorities. All of that results in telling people that they belong, that they're important, and that they have a voice in the community. What about Muslims who are coming back to Islam or are just learning about Islam? How do we respond to them? I remember being at a masjid, and a young woman came in, green hair, body pierced all over, looked like she didn't belong in the masjid, or whatever that looks like. And I saw the reaction of the young girls who are the leaders of the community. They looked at her, looked at each other, and started whispering. And I waited to see what would happen. And they just ignored her. I went up to them later on, and I said, what happened? Why didn't you invite her, talk to her? And they looked at me like, what are you talking about? What we do or not do, our action or inaction, has an impact on the lives of people. It makes them feel like they belong. We don't know if she was coming to the masjid to seek spiritual guidance. We don't know if she was coming to make tawbah. We have no idea. But it's very possible by them not reaching out to her and making her feel welcome, they could have pushed her away. I never saw that girl again in the masjid, just so you know. And so the question we have to ask ourselves is, are we hurting them, those who are marginalized? And what people don't realize is we're also hurting ourselves and our akhirah. Because we're going to have to be answering to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about whether or not we were the reason that prevented them from being engaged with the community, from learning more and connecting more and serving Him. We're going to be asked about this question. And the second thing we don't realize is those individuals who are not necessarily within the kind of the mainstream of the community, the kind of the culture that is the norm, those are the very individuals you need to help us think outside the box, to help us question the norms that we have and we within the community, and help us make Islam more vibrant. And so what happens often, there'll be a few who will stay and fight and argue and try to get their voice heard, but the vast majority, they're the ones who disengage. They're the ones who kind of say, you know what? I'm not dealing with this. It's not worth my time and energy. This results in isolation. This can impact their iman. And who's to blame for that? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, O you who believe, be maintainers of justice, bearers of witness of Allah's sake, even though it may be against your own selves, or your parents, or near relatives, if he be rich or poor. Allah is nearer to them, both in compassion. Therefore, do not allow your low desires, lest you deviate. And if you serve or turn aside, then surely Allah is aware of what you do. Allah is reminding us we have to stand up for justice. It's not an option. We have to stand up, and as a community, we're failing. We're failing to meet the needs of our community and our diverse community. Why? Because we don't want to get out of our comfort zone. This is the way we've practiced. This is what feels comfortable. I don't want to try this type of thing. I don't want to question the norms that I've had. It's just easier. And plus, we're the majority, right? These are the things that we say, and these are the things, and subhanAllah, Allah points out your own desires. Those are the things that get in the way. Your desires, your family, your friends, those are the obstacles. So we need to look first at that and get over that hump. Because most of us are lazy. Most of us don't want to go and do something that's going to cause tension within the community or cause extra work for me. Because you know what? It doesn't impact me. But realize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us that we need to take this issue as an individual and community responsibility. We need to take action to make sure that our spaces and places are open and inclusive spaces. People need to feel welcome. They need to feel that they belong and that they are growing in these spaces and that they matter. And so those of us who are not marginalized, who are in a place of privilege, we need to become allies for those who are often marginalized. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, the believing men and the believing women are allies to one another. They enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong, and establish prayers and give zakah and obey Allah and His messengers. Those, Allah reminds us, those will have Allah's mercy upon them. Indeed, Allah is exalted, mighty, and wise. SubhanAllah. Whether or not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy upon us is intimately tied with whether or not we are fulfilling our responsibilities and serving as His wali. Are we looking after, are we supporting, are we serving as allies for those who may not have a voice? Are we centering their, giving them an opportunity to have a place to say in their experience? The responsibility of creating safe spaces and empowering spaces needs to come from those of us who are privileged. Those who are marginalized can work and work hard, but we are the ones, those of us who are privileged, are the ones that can help be their ally. Maybe we're part of the dominant ethnic group in the masjid. Maybe we're in a leadership position within the community. Or we have personal connections to those who do. Maybe we have certain professional backgrounds. Whatever it is, we need to lend it to help those who are marginalized and give them a voice. And the thing is, other people may not know what those privileges are, but you and Allah know. And Allah knows what you have the capability of doing. And Allah knows if you don't use it for those who are marginalized. And Allah will take us to account on the Day of Judgment whether or not we use our privilege or not. We don't have the luxury to say, it doesn't impact me, so it's not my problem. It's not a luxury, right? The Prophet ﷺ said, the parable of the believer in their affliction, the parable of the believer in their affection, mercy, and compassion for each other is that of a body. When any limb aches, the whole body reacts with sleeplessness and fever. It's not their issue, it's not your issue, it's our issue. Again, if everyone's not at the table, we're not having that creative voice. We don't have a creative approach to Islam. And so we have a religious duty and responsibility to dismantle the systems within our community that continue to marginalize others. So given that this is our responsibility, What are things that we can do? Now, the topic is large, and there are many different groups within the Muslim community that are marginalized. So what I'm going to do is just give you general ideas, and I know there's different topics that are going to be addressed throughout the convention. But there are four actions that each and every one of us can do, regardless of all the different groups who are marginalized. First, recognize your privilege, right? If you are here today at the convention, you are privileged, period. You can afford being here because not everyone has a disposable income to come to these conventions. It's expensive. And so you're privileged just to be here. You are likely privileged to have had a positive experience with Islam. Not everybody has that opportunity. Many people have had negative experiences because of whoever has been teaching them Islam, right? So thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of your privilege. Remember him and be grateful. But also realize that there's a lot of privilege that you have that you may not recognize. And that you be open to discovering and unpackaging all those privileges. Because those of us who are in privilege have no clue what it's like to be marginalized. Second, educate yourself. If you don't see it, know it, feel it, or experience it, you have no understanding of how important this topic is. You have no understanding of the power dynamics, the history, the experiences of marginalization, the mental health impact, how it impacts your work, your life, all of it. You need to learn. And this learning needs to be an ongoing basis. If you want to learn more about anti-racism efforts, then really, in terms of the Muslim community, really look up Muslim ARC. They're doing a phenomenal job. They need help and their support, but they're doing work. Get on their email list, sign up, support them, invite them into your community. They have lots of different resources. If you want to look, again, along that line, if you want to learn more about social justice, follow people like Marguerite Hill, Camila Mutman Rashad, Donna Austin, Namira Islam, Khalid Baydoun, Linda Sarsour. Follow them on Twitter. Follow them on Facebook. They post a lot of different good articles and thoughts. Help educate yourself. If you're interested in terms of learning about mental health stigma, in terms of individuals who are marginalized because of illnesses, or families, or young people, or converts, all of these different groups, how are they feeling marginalized, and what can you do, and how can you support? The Family and Youth Institute has a number of articles that we send out on a weekly basis, practical, clinical-based, they're meant for you to read and understand, even if it's not part of the group that you're part of. Learn, read, it increases your knowledge, and it allows you to be more responsive to their needs in a timely basis. For those interested, if you want to learn more about the disability community and what their issues and challenges are, Mohsen is there. They have a lot of resources there. There's a lot of topics in terms of enabled Muslims. So all of this knowledge is an ongoing life process. You're never going to get it all. But the fact that you're on that path of constantly learning and educating ourselves, it will help you understand what's your privilege, what are your opportunities of helping, and then allow you to push for change. And so that's the third thing I'm asking everyone to do. Push for change and be the change. Create spaces and give individuals who are marginalized a space and place to speak their truth. Don't speak it for them. Let them speak it. Because likely, if you speak it for them, you're going to mess it up. So be a good ally and please give them a space. And don't wait for someone to tell them and knock on your door and say, I need you to do this for me. Having the knowledge gives you the space to say, hey, let me ask this person, would this be helpful to you? Would this be of benefit? Right? I remember one of my friends, she was going through a divorce, and she used to be very active in the community, and she slowly started leaving the community. Why? She didn't feel like she belonged anywhere because everybody was married. All their kids had their dads, and it was hard for her. It felt awkward. And as a result, she started moving away. Alhamdulillah, her friends recognized it, and they jumped in. And part of the issue is she was just overwhelmed and exhausted. And we helped support her in that process so she didn't get to the point of feeling marginalized. And in that support, childcare, emotional, spending time with her, being there, so helping her feel like she belonged to the community, she slowly came back and started getting more involved and contributing to the community. But what that requires is you have to understand the needs. You have to be out there and getting involved and asking before that person has to ask. So if you're in a gathering, and a group of people, be it your friends or anybody or your family members, if they're saying something racist or, you know, negative about other people, judging other people, break the cycle. Interrupt the behavior. Because Allah knows you were there. The angels are writing. This person acted or didn't act. And you're going to come back to the scene on the Day of Judgment. So realize and keep that in mind. And the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, support your brother, whether he is an oppressor or being oppressed. And the companions, many of us know, asked, O Messenger of Allah, we help the one being oppressed, but how do we help an oppressor? The Prophet replied, by seizing his hand. You know, realize this is not going to be easy, right? But you have to use whatever is at your disposal to make and interrupt that behavior. It may be hard and open you to a lot of hurt and sacrifices, but remember, again, your actions are going to be accounted for on the Day of Judgment. Your inactions are too. So push for change in the community before it's too late for yourself. And for those of you who are interested in Black Lives Matter and wanting to make a change on the ground, there are a number of us within MASS who are working to develop a more systematic, organized effort to help bring about that change. So if you are interested, please talk to me. Please talk to Akhil. Akhil, do you mind, Hernandi? We're all part of the committee. So please come up to us. Give us your contact information. We're rolling it out soon. We're not there yet, but you know, we need all hands on deck. So please talk to us. Again, Muslim ARC is there. There's also the FYI for mental health and family. Peaceful Families and Project Sakina are there for domestic violence. Project Heart Women and Girls is there for sexual abuse. There's tons of organizations serving the Muslim community who are trying to help support and give voice to the marginalized communities within our community. You need to take the ownership. You need to take the responsibility and make the change for your akhirah. Nobody else, your akhirah. And the fourth point that I wanted to make was when we do this work, it's critical that we engage in muhasibah, self-reflection, taking yourself into account. Constantly reflect and try to unpack your internal biases and others based on their otherness. If you're lucky, you'll have people around you, and make sure you surround yourself with people who are going to take you to account. When you mess up, they tell you, you know, that wasn't exactly very helpful as an ally. And you got to be cool about that, right? Don't get offended. Don't, you know, take what they say with a gift, no matter how they point it out. They are helping you help your akhirah. Also, sometimes in this work, while we're trying to dismantle these issues within the community, it's very easy to become arrogant. It's very easy to become self-righteous. Because now we are educated. We are enlightened. Right? avoid that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, and do not turn your cheek in contempt towards people. And do not walk through the earth exultantly. Indeed, Allah does not like everyone self-deluded and boastful. Right? Be humble, respectful, and kind when tackling community challenges, when trying to dismantle the oppressive practices within our community. People are more likely to implement change when it's coming from a place of love and kindness than arrogance and haughtiness. So if each one of us were to take the responsibility for having the mindset of being awliya, or allies to one another, as Allah directs us in Surah Tawbah, again, the believing men and the believing women are allies to one another. They enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong. If you just focus on four things, that's all I ask you to remember at the end of this talk. Four things. One, acknowledge our privilege. Two, educate ourselves. Three, be the change. And four, reflect. Engage in self-reflection, taking yourself into account, muhasiba. We can have that impact, and inshallah gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the process. Let us pray that we are among those individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon the day of judgment, when we will be judged for our actions and our inactions. We ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us as we try to create spaces for those who don't have a voice. That He gives us patience, perseverance, and wisdom to help transform our communities into healthy, vibrant places. And we ask that we are the means for the transformation process. Jazakallahu khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum. Jazakallah khair for coming to this particular session, because I think it's particularly important at this time when America is experiencing so much diversity as there is, there's still a lot of detachment. And up until recently, I think up until the last maybe 3 years, some people said there's too much talk about race and racism in America. I think there's not enough. Because certain privileges go unnoticed. Can I have water? Certain privileges go unnoticed, and we become adapted to how things are, that we continually lack the courage to bring up certain subjects about marginalization. And to be honest with you, when I became a Muslim, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy because there were communities that were primarily black Muslim communities, and then there were communities that were Arab communities and Pakistani communities, but there was that clear division. And I don't think that clear division has really changed. It has changed to an extent, but not as much as it should be changed. And sometimes, even in Muslim communities, the most blatant acts of racial bigotry are ignored. How many of you go to or are part of Muslim communities that has a diversified board? Okay, how many of you, so we can see the impact, how many of you do not? And we did a study of Muslim communities across the nation to see who was on the board, who was on the executive committees, and it was really basically dependent on who the majority in that community is. And when I became a Muslim, I was a little bit more lucky than others. Because I was an American, because I was a person of color, I was sort of embraced. Okay? I was the only chocolate chip in the cookie, but I was embraced. And it bothered me. Where is everybody? Why isn't there more diversity? Because I had lived a life where there was diversity. where it really wasn't a lot of focus on the color of your skin, but on your religion. At that time, I was raised, my parents had me in Catholic school for most of my life. But in the last 4 years, we've seen not just the rise of Islamophobia, we've seen black racism against black, especially young black people. It's become uncontrollable. And you see, what is the purpose of Black Lives Matter? Well, the purpose of Black Lives Matter was to address how many black people are actually being harmed by law enforcement, how many are being discriminated against, how many are marginalized to the extent that they're no longer the person that they were because they're filled with anger from prejudice and discrimination. Now, there's an author, his name is Carl Rowan. He wrote The Coming Race War in America, A Wake-Up Call, in which he warns of the growing threat of white supremacist militia groups plotting to ignite racial conflict. And that's true. We have certain communities that have also been white racist supremacists actually join certain communities and promote conflict. And oftentimes, we don't know what's going on in our own community. But there were signs that were there. If you belong to a Muslim community where the majority of people are the majority of your own race, then we have a problem. And we've got to ask ourselves, what's happening here? We need to break the silence about racism wherever we can. We need to talk about it at home, at school, in our houses of worship, in our workplaces, and in our community group. But talk is cheap. We need to do something about it. If there's going to be meaningful change, then productive dialogue raises consciousness but also leads to effective action. Now, how many of you in this room are black Americans? Okay, this is Chicago. There are a lot of black American Muslims, and there should be more too. So that means our outreach should be more effective, and communities that are primarily black Americans should be invited to come, invited to participate, and I'm depending on you because I think most of you are millennials. How many of you are under the age of 35? Okay, well, you've got your task ahead of you. Because a lot of times we think because we're Muslim, we don't have to acknowledge the things that are hurting some people the most. We need to be able to go to our community leaders and point out there's a problem. In fact, I have always advocated for whenever there's an executive committee at a masjid or an Islamic center, part of that community should be young people under the age of 35, like me. Just kidding. It means that since you all recognize certain things that the older generation doesn't recognize, you've got to bring it to their attention. If you don't do that, maybe it continues to go years and years unnoticed. And I've been to this convention, other conventions for years and years, and I still see there's a problem of diversity. I still see that there's a problem in multicultural thought and inclusion. And it bothers me because the road coming is going to be much more harder. If you think we were tested before, you ain't seen nothing yet. We will be tested in maybe, inshallah, I mean, I don't know what Allah plans, but we will be tested in ways that we never expected. And the way that we will be primarily tested is a certain group of society, certain elements that will want to divide us instead of bring us together. If we're not together, that's going to be a problem. The impact of racism begins early. Even in our preschool years, we are exposed to information about people different from ourselves. How many of you grew up in Muslim communities and Muslim neighbors where you literally live next door to Muslims, who are your neighbors? Okay, well, when these situations occur in the community, the Islamic community and centers, and then you go back to your house, you're literally surrounded by same people that are, you know, it's a sameness that's established between you and your neighbors. I'm guilty. I live in a neighborhood, primarily I would say 65% are Arabs, 20% are Indo-Pakistanis, Indians, and the thing is that, so that makes like maybe almost 80%, a little bit less, are Muslims. The one thing I notice is that the 15% that aren't Muslims, they group us all the same, so we're mutually disturbed by our presence. Some say because we drive too fast in the neighborhoods, I don't know. But yeah, we do intend, we often ignore the rules. So when we look at our community structures, we see segregated communities. We don't see the other. Even though we are a religious community that has been structured more than 1,400 years ago to live by the social model set by the prophet, alayhi salam, and even then, there were problems. Bilal, may Allah be pleased with him, was probably one of the greatest figures in Islam. But yet, he felt discriminated against. And he had to overcome so many hurdles to prove, yes, I am a Muslim, I am equal to you, and I deserve the respect of other Muslims, regardless of where they're from. So if you have been in a Muslim school, because the fact is a lot of Muslim schools they cost about between $500 and $700 a month. A lot of Black American Muslims will have a problem with this. There is some who will not, but a large group will be affected by the fact that they cannot afford this type of tuition. So what you have are a selected group of peoples being educated in a Muslim school. When the most important thing should not be about just having people who are able to pay a certain fee for tuition, but having diversity. Even if the community must help others to be included, because if we're not doing that, we are literally criminals of the, we are same like the bigots and racists that we see attacking all Muslims in this society. And it seems hard to imagine that anyone is still unaware of racism in our society, but in fact, I've been in certain situations speaking to different types of audience, and there's always someone that will say, well, racism is a thing of the past. Racism is not a thing of the past, okay? When you see people gunned down in the streets because police officers might think they have a gun based on their color, that's racism. When you see sisters, Muslim women, women of color, unable to find a husband because of their race, that's a problem. When we continue to judge people by their color instead of their Islamic character, there's still a problem. For people of color, it can become so frustrating. And the anger is so soul-ridden that they decide to establish communities of their own. And that's a problem. Why is it that we live in a society that talks about human rights, about a multicultural society, but still you have this masjid who's primarily Black, and you have that masjid who's primarily Arab? Why? And they can be within 2 miles of each other. Why is that? These are things that we need to address. And the messages sent by societies that are racially isolated. Sometimes, I'm going to tell you, Black people are afraid to address the issues just as much as non-Black people are afraid to address the issue. But maintaining this connection makes us weaker in this society. When I first became Muslim, which was decades ago, I was in a convention in Indiana. I was registering. I was really excited. I was new to the Muslim community, and I wanted to see this convention. I wanted to see the topics that they discuss. And I was in line, And a guy came, and he literally got in front of me, and I tried to move up a little bit, and he kicked me. Well, at that time, my Islamic etiquette was not as developed as it is now, so I kicked him back. Don't do that. What you do is you say, "Brother, I was here first. What would make you do that?" And I knew immediately, he didn't have to tell me, but he had a lower, let's say a higher concept of himself than he had of me. And although my anger levels have become more refined, I'm becoming more impatient with the need to organize, impatient with the need for us to have a common understanding, impatient that how many of you have actually read a black book by a black person? How many? Well, that's pretty good. But everyone should not just read books by Muslim black scholars, but read about the history of black people, because you're going to be able to compare it what's going on to the Muslim community today. You're no longer on the outside looking in. You're inside an area filled with discrimination, filled with hate, filled with that is really affecting the equilibrium of all Muslim communities. And I think in the next 4 years, you're going to see more of what I just described. Because the president-elect Trump, he didn't say, "I want a registry of black American Muslims." He didn't say, "I want a registry of Arab Muslims or Pakistani or Indian Muslims." He wants a registry of all Muslims. And the fact that you're a citizen doesn't mean you're going to escape anything. If we don't learn to organize ourselves, to create a strong sense of solidarity, we won't be able to overcome the hurdles that are definitely in front of us. We won't, because our weaknesses will transcend our strengths. And we will need everyone to be literally a foot soldier, showing that we're one, we are the Ummah of the Prophet alayhi salam, and that means we stand as one. And we grow our muscles to demand mutual respect, whether our brother is black or Chinese or Hispanic. We've got to do that. Or if we don't do it, you're going to be marginalized to the extent that you will be investigated, you will be sidelined, you will be detained, and you're going to need, really, American Muslims that have a history of this problem and have learned to overcome it to defend you. I work at Mass Immigrant Justice Center, and of course, black Americans and Latino Americans, they don't have a big need for immigration services unless they are undocumented aliens. But sometimes I wonder, if that was my situation, who would come to defend me? Black Americans need to be defended. Latino American Muslims need to be defended. And we need to create not just outreach for internal work and action, but an outreach for external action. We need to develop solidarity with groups like Black Lives Matter, like the NAACP, and volunteering for the ACLU, because the days, this day and time, these groups are reaching out, literally laying out the olive branch to help us. But if we're unaware of them, if we're unaware of the causes that they want to represent in our name, we're lost. We're part of an American society with a specific group of duties as Muslims, as Americans. And unless we embrace that, unless we grow our camaraderie, it's going to be so hard for your children growing up. I don't know how many of you have children, but unless we develop a strong foundation Then we're going to be, how many of you know Native American Indians? Well, some Native American Indians, I guess they look at Ancestry.com, I don't know. But they say, oh, my great-grandmother was an American Indian. No, this cannot be our story. This cannot be our legacy. Either we're going to be a strong group that raise our children to stand next to each other, not just in Salat, but in the community, then we're going to be a society that says our children, great-grandchildren will say, oh, my grandmother was a Muslim. That can't be. If we're in this country, one of our primary responsibilities is to build a power base for the Ummah in this society. And we can't do it if we're detached. We can't do it unless we look into our hearts and souls and realize that we need a force right inside the masjid. We need to encourage diversity by getting the input of all people of color. This is our duty, and this is the goal I hope all of you will strive for. Thank you.
Question, inshallah, is going to be, it's kind of like almost like a two-part. The first one is, if you do happen to be part of a privileged community and you are a leader, what are some tangible steps you can take to bring the marginalized and non-marginalized communities together?
First of all, if you were part of a privileged class, you're not now, okay? Things have changed. Things have changed to the point where those who could skate by are no longer able to skate by. Especially those who are visual signs of Islam. I don't care what color you are. You can be the white of the whitest or the dark of the darkest. When you wear that scarf, you're not privileged anymore. You can have a really good professional job, but when you walk into some of the offices now, or even when you apply for a job, privilege is something you don't get. So, if you're a leader in a Muslim community, then you need to lead a situation to create a situation where Muslims have an understanding that now privilege has been redefined.
Just for specifically within the Muslim community, a lot depends on the leadership responsibilities you have. One of the things, if you're on the Masjid leadership or the MSA leadership, really, you know, you're going to have programming within their community. Make sure your programming is able to address all the different groups that are marginalized within the community. So invite Muslim Mark there, invite FYI, invite Mohsen, invite all of these organizations. You don't have to have the knowledge. You just need to get them to come in and have those conversations. Many of these organizations already have khutbahs ready for you if you want to have the khatib to give a talk on this topic. You really need to be organized in the masjids. Have khatibs talk about these topics. Have programmings. Like, you are the individuals who make the decisions within the community. So have programming there. Two, also have opportunities where people feel comfortable to share feedback about what's going right or what's not going right within the community. You know, it could be in groups, in group meetings, or going up to people who you know are marginalized and asking them, how can we make this community more responsive to you? Sometimes they may want more time to think about it. Have a feedback system where they can email that. Whatever. You want to create more opportunities for people to give you a sense of what's going on. Sometimes they don't feel comfortable presenting it because of the power dynamics. Acknowledge those power dynamics and realize and help create those opportunities so that they feel comfortable sharing it in whatever way they feel most comfortable with. And sometimes just inviting someone from outside helps you start that conversation.
I just want to say one thing. We represent people in court, and we don't really get a choice of who we represent. If it's an immigrant that needs help, it's our duty to help that person. So
I was coming out of the immigration court and I saw a guy sitting on the steps. He was crying. And we're so overwhelmed, I said, Khalila, just keep walking. But I couldn't keep walking. So I went over to him. I said, what's wrong? And he told me what his situation was. I went to court. He's gay. I went to court, and I'm wearing my Islamic dress, and it was obvious to the judge that he's gay. And for the judge to see this Muslim and this gay guy, the judge literally started laughing. And I got to know this guy, and I asked him, so what's your story? And he talked about the fact that he was sold and molested since he was 6 years old. And the horrors of his life are what led to him defining who he is and how he feels and about, gender. So always remember, everybody has a story. And if you don't know what that story is, then don't prejudge. Because you don't know how far a little bit of kindness and generosity can go to helping a person come to terms with their life. And even if they don't become Muslim, embracing certain ideas as Muslims.
How do we speak with our parents, elders, aunties, grandpas, family about the blatant racism and sexism they have without disrespecting them or alienating them, especially in a culture where arguing with them is completely unacceptable?
How many of you have seen, it's an old movie, it's called Guess Who's Coming to Dinner? Invite your friends of color to dinner. Open the door to communication. I doubt they're going to say, what the heck, get them out of here. I doubt they're going to do that. But sometimes the older generation needs just as much or more education than the younger generation. And you all, many of you, I assume, are attending college and other different situations where you meet other Muslims from different backgrounds. Nothing changes without exposure. And then you need to explain to the elders about some things that you have perceived and help change their perception. You are never too old to learn. Never too old to learn. And you just got to open the door, and you got to be courageous. And it's not disrespecting them, because you know what? You want them to appear in front of Allah as well as they can on the day of judgment. You want to be able that when your grandparents die or your parents die, that they were practicing the kind of Islam that Allah wants them to practice, that they were generous and kind to all people. You can be the source of change. But you just got to be courageous, and you got to stand up for what's right.
Just want to share a couple of other ideas for those of you who are indirect communicators. I'm one of those. So I had to learn how to do those things as well. So a couple things you might want to consider. Use movies as an opportunity. 13th came out recently on Netflix. And that's a great thing. Say, hey, let's have a movie night. And you watch that together, that's a great way to bring up the conversation, open it up, and say, how much of this are we doing? Do we understand why are there issues within the Black community? Use books, like maybe you're reading a book, Michelle Alexander's book. What's the name of the book? New Jim Crow, right? That's you have that around the book, around the house. Discuss it. This is what I'm reading. This is how what's going on. And so you start putting the seeds down and start chipping things away, having those conversations with your family about what's going on. Or when you're at the masjid, make sure that there are khutbahs on the topic. Or when you see blatant racism that's taking place, or about not just racism, but other areas as well in terms of stigma, in terms of mental illness. When you see it, point it out. If your parents are doing it in a respectful way, you can ask and say, look, I noticed you did that, but do you realize that this is the implications of what you did?
Do you realize how that might have impacted them? Sometimes many of our parents are just ignorant about these topics, and they don't realize. They take the narrative that's in mainstream America, and they say, yeah, why is there black-on-black crime? Why don't they get their act together, right? There is a history of institutionalized racism. We need to help our parents understand that, show that, explain it, and over time, you help that they start seeing it as well. Sometimes they don't realize when they're yelling at somebody, when they bring in their wheelchair in the salon area, how that could be so hurtful to them, right? They don't realize the impact it has on the other individual. They're so focused on what they see in their perspective. You need to chip away at those realities and help them understand that what's going on for them.
One thing, and show them the statistics. Some of the most awful crimes in this country are not being perpetrated by black people and Hispanics, okay? So we'll ignore Trump's statements about that. If you look at certain crimes like molestation, if you look at certain crimes like rape, if you look at certain crimes like murder, the statistics go way up high for other groups than Hispanics and black people. But these distortions and are specifically made to affect a population of people so they will discriminate. Just like the majority of terrorism acts are perpetrated not by Muslims, but by religious white supremacists, okay? So teach them the truth. Show them the statistics. You know, set a time for family conversation and talk about these things. Because a lot of people, it's an illusion. The things that they believe, it's an illusion.
Wanted to add one more point. Sorry about that. The other thing is also when we talk about other groups that we're not part of, it's always otherized, right? We don't connect with them. And so part of it is make it more personal and say, you know how you don't like being, stereotyped about Muslims? You know how, bring it home to them. Say, you know how you don't like that? Well, is it possible that the same may be true of other groups? And then go through that process of helping them realize, just like you don't like to be, stereotyped because of your religious beliefs or your cultural beliefs, why should we allow for anybody else? And so that's another way as well to make it more real.
Okay, jazakallah khair, everybody. That wraps up our Q&A. That is all the time we have for today, inshallah. Please give another round of applause to our two speakers.